Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. God sent his son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy he gives. But greater still, the calm assurance this child can face uncertain days because he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross the river, I'll fight life's final war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory and I'll know he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
And all God's people said, amen, because he lives. Thank you, gentlemen. I want to welcome you here to our memorial service today in honor of the Crowders, and thank you for being here. And welcome family and friends who've come to be an encouragement here at this service. And we look to God's word. We look to the people of God to find encouragement, and we know that we have hope in the word of God and in the person of Jesus Christ. And in the time of loss, we can encourage one another as we think about the things that are true. So we're going to do that in this service today. But as we start, let's open with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we are so honored and privileged to be able to be here as family and friends. loved ones, to encourage one another, the loss here on earth, but again in heaven, for a dear saint of God who's been faithful and run the course, kept the faith. Lord, we pray that you would bless this memorial service with the music and the words, the testimonies, the scripture, preaching of God's word. Point us to our hope in Jesus Christ, that even though we sorrow, it is not without hope. And Lord, be with Brother Roger today and the family, that they would be encouraged by the words, the songs that have been sung already and played, that we would see Jesus. In your name that we pray, amen. We are going to sing together, so if you'll stand, please. We're going to sing "To God Be the Glory, Great Things He Has Done."
To God.
Amen. You may be seated.
Psalm 118:23. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. On Sunday evening, March 10th, 2024, Sharon K. Johnson Crowder of Huntsville, Alabama, entered the presence of her Lord and Savior, which is marvelous in our eyes. Sharon was born on March 9, 1942, to Leslie and Lois Johnson of Caldwell, Idaho. The youngest of three children, Sharon graduated in 1960 from Caldwell High School. On February 5, 1961, Sharon became the beloved wife of Roger Atlas Crowder. God blessed their family with two daughters. After a short stint as a Navy wife, God moved their family to Fremont, Michigan, where they were active at First Baptist Church of Fremont. In 1973, God moved the family again to Greenville, South Carolina, where Sharon's husband, Roger, prepared for a preaching ministry. After 4 years in South Carolina, They moved to Illinois, where she faithfully served alongside her husband as a pastor's wife. After 7 years of ministering in Paris, Illinois, God chose them to serve him in Porto Alegre, Brazil. Sharon faithfully served with her husband in Brazil for almost 28 years. At the age of 43, she learned a new language, taught children Sunday school classes, helped homeschool the missionary children, and was the consummate hostess for the church congregation and visiting pastors, friends, and other missionaries. After retiring from the ministry in Brazil in 2012, she began, with Roger, a ministry to other missionaries around the world as furlough replacements. These places included the Philippines, Cape Verde, Argentina, Brazil, and ending in Scotland. She returned to Huntsville in 2016, where they became actively involved in the missions program at Calvary Baptist Church in Huntsville. Sharon lived out the love of the Lord in her life by loving others. She was known at the church as one who deeply cared for others, always asking questions about family members, entertaining people in her home, and praying for others. She had a way of making each person she talked to feel special and loved. She was a wonderful wife, a loving mother, grandmother, great-grandmother, and friend. She selflessly gave of herself in all of these relationships. She was predeceased in death by her parents, Leslie and Lois Johnson, and her two siblings. She is survived by her husband of 63 years, Roger Crowder, daughters Shelley and Tim Shimkus of Virginia, and Kelly and Mark Ballard of Pennsylvania. She leaves a heritage that is the Lord's doing of love and faith in Christ. 5 grandchildren, Abigail Rose, Bethany Rose, Susanna Shimkus, Richard Shimkus, Amelia Roll, and 6 great-grandchildren. In memory of Sharon, donations can be made to Calvary Baptist Church Mission Fund, care of Mike Ring for Brazilian Ministries. And for our Brazilian friends that are watching on live stream, para os nossos amigos do Brasil que estão assistindo, obrigado por prestigiar este culto memorial da nossa querida Dona Sharon. Demos graças a Deus por este tesouro de uma pessoa que Ele nos emprestou por tempo aqui na Terra. Ela foi uma pessoa bem simpática, quem amava as pessoas. Para ela, ninguém foi estranho. A razão disto é por causa do seu amor por Deus. Ela lembrava as datas de aniversário de todo o mundo e as pessoas que passavam na Igreja Batista Fundamental, bairro Tristeza, de Porto Alegre. Ela fazia os bolinhos de lembrança. Vamos sentir a falta do amor e carinho dela, mas para nós que somos salvos em Cristo Jesus, temos a esperança de vê-la novamente no céu, logo, logo. E lá vamos adorar juntos o nosso Senhor e Salvador para sempre. Salmo 118, 23. Foi o Senhor que fez isto, e é a coisa maravilhosa aos nossos olhos. Tchau por enquanto, e até breve.
Shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye, all is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be, when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace, when he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be. Thank you. there. No more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no pain, no more parting over there, and forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace, when he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace, when he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be.
Scripture reading we have this afternoon is taken from two passages of Scripture, one in the New Testament and one in the Old, 2 Corinthians 5, verse 6, 7, and 8. Paul writes this, says, "Therefore we are always confident, knowing that whilst we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord, for we walk by faith and not by sight. We are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord." And then in Psalm 118, verses 19 to 24, David says this, the psalmist writes, "Open to me the gates of righteousness, and I will go in into them, and I will praise the Lord. This gate of the Lord into which the righteous shall enter, I will praise thee, for thou hast heard me and art become my salvation. The stone which the builders refused is become the headstone of the corner. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes." In verse 28 and 29, "Thou art my God, I will praise thee. Thou art my God, I will exalt thee. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever." We're going to stand again and sing a song, "I Am Redeemed," and be on the screen here. We stand together to sing this together.
Redemption song, I will bow before my Savior.
you. You may be seated.
So thankful for the wonderful example of this sweet lady that the Lord brought into our lives and was part of our family. She helped me homeschool my children. She gave a love of cooking for my daughters. And when my daughter Noelle, who is our third child, who's a missionary in the northern part of Brazil, heard Aunt Sharon, who she called Aunt Sharon, go on to glory, she sat down and wrote this poem, which I would like to read to you. It's called Remember Me, dedicated to Aunt Sharon Crowder, written with love by Noelle Ring Smothers on March the 10th, 2024. Remember me smiling. Remember when I would make a new recipe. Remember when I would pretend it turned out terribly? Remember when I would blush at your expression of delight? Remember when I would invite you over to try it again to make sure it was really right? Remember me smiling. Remember me praying. Remember I wasn't always where the spotlight shone. Remember I would try to make everyone feel at home. Remember my laugh and my compassionate gaze. Remember how I always listened with grace. Remember that I loved you no matter your name. Remember me praying. Remember me loving. Remember me not with tears of sadness. Remember me for the joys that we shared. Remember the gladness found in poetry recitation and spelling words and movie nights. Remember me delighting as you grew up before my eyes. Remember my counsel and my heart for your future. Remember me loving.
Certainly, our wonderful friend and colleague, Sharon Crowder, has left her an indelible mark on the lives of not only the missionaries, but the ministry of Porto Alegre, Brazil. Remember this precious lady, how we first met the Crowders. I had been given a prayer card with just an old picture that they had used for their coming to the field, and I had never met Roger. There was no cell phones, and so we got off the bus after an 18-hour bus trip from Sao Paulo, weary and worn, and we began to scan the people that were there trying to find out where's this Roger Crowder person. And I noticed this rather large, tall man walking back and forth, and this little lady trotting right along behind him. And about the third time he came by, I said, "Are you Roger Crowder? Are you Mike Ring?" And that's how we met at the bus station in Porto Alegre, Brazil in 1992. And God bonded our lives, our ministries, our families, our love together in a way that only he can get the glory for. We knew her in two special ways in Brazil. If you went to church with a Brazilian, she was Dona Sharon. Dona Sharon, Mrs. Sharon, was very well known, as has already been mentioned, by her adeptness to all kinds of dates and all kinds of details. She could tell me, even up until the end, the clothes that I was wearing the first day we met. She knew the color of someone whose car had crashed. She knew the color of the car. She knew the car tag number. I thought very appropriate, one of the pastors who was led to the Lord through the Crowder's ministry and shared with me just this morning that 75 members of his family have come to Christ as their Savior, Danielle Bortoluzzi. He said, when I was in the church in Tristeza, I knew I was saved, and I knew it was around, I had received Christ around Easter time, but I couldn't remember the date. So he said, I asked just one day, I was making mention of that in Donna Sharon, Mrs. Crowder, Sharon Crowder's presence. I don't remember the date. She just whipped out her little book. She said, Danielle Bortoluzzi, April the 14th, 1990. He said, that's it. You're right. And she was so amazing with the date. She knew all of my children. and now 15 grandchildren. She would tell me when their birthdays were. So what an amazing memory the Lord gave her. She was a surrogate grandmother, and we thank the grandchildren for allowing our children to grow up with your grandparents. I know my parents back in the States said, I don't feel like your kids really know us. Well, God gave us the grandparents on the field that our children so desperately wanted to have, and the Lord blessed them with a Sharon. One of the special memories is how she took care of Nicholas. Nicholas is our son, who's about Brother Roger's size now, but when he was just a little guy, so that Tammy could play the piano, and there was no nursery, Sharon would sit there and hold little Nick in her arms and hold him real tight so he wouldn't get out, or so he wouldn't holler out, Pipoca Amen, which means popcorn, amen. So she was, her duty was to take care of Nicholas, and she did such a wonderful job of that. She has been called the church's computer. Anything that you needed to know about anything about the church, she was very right there with that particular thing that you needed to know. And I think one of the greatest blessings was when we had a conference every year, we had a conference for the founding of the church, we would bring the pastors up to the front of the church platform, and Sharon would have every one of the dates when the church was founded, what the occasion was, and she knew every one of those details about the Ponta Grossa Church that came out of Tristeza, about the Guayba Church, about the Canoas Church, about the Santa Maria Church, about the San Sapad Church, and most recent about the La Mi Church and the Villanova Church. All this was because of this dear lady and her husband dedicating their lives to the Lord and the ministry. As Roger has said, God gave him that fruit that would remain. We thank the Lord for that. Her favorite expression to those of us that were missionaries was, remember where you live. We would have one of those days where we'd go stand in a bank line, 96 people in front of you to pay one bank bill, and when you got that paid, you had to go to some other bank. She'd say, Mike, remember where we live. You would be driving along, and a car would stop in front of you, and you would stop, but the motorcycle would run into the back of you, and the person then would lie out on the ground until the policeman could come on the bus, and he writes you up a ticket for causing an accident. And I go home, Sharon, this doesn't make sense. Mike, remember where you live. Well, Roger, remember where she lives. Because he lives, she lives, and we know where Sharon lives, and very soon we're going to go to be with her. What an expression that was, and it was such a blessing for us to be a part of those meals, as has already been mentioned by Tammy and Noel in her poem. But some of the poems that they learned, just little children's poems. The owl and the pussycat went to sea in a beautiful pea green boat. I'll never forget that, because she worked with those kids on that until they could see it. And it was such a blessing. They would say their little poems, and then the blessing came because she would whoop out that Taste of Home recipe book and start bringing out those recipes. Two of them that I can remember right off the top of my stomach are the chili bake and the spaghetti stroganoff. Those two have lived on and will live on forever in our family and so many other families, and it was such a blessing to have her do that. And sometimes she would give that little, well, I don't know if this turned out well or not, and then once we said, oh, it did, oh, she was so excited and so thrilled about that. I hope that the challenge of her life, her love for the souls of lost men and women, and she would always tell us that, you know, I'm not that person in the spotlight, but I just want to stay back here and pray and encourage, and she was such a prayer warrior and such an encouragement, and we want to her memory to live on in Brazil in the lives of the pastors' wives and of these new generations being raised up for the Lord, as we remember this family that has given their life for the Lord Jesus Christ, and he has certainly done marvelous things for which we are glad. I praise the Lord with all my heart for giving me the joy and the privilege of knowing Sharon Crowder and to know that we're going to be together forever.
Have I often have hid my face while the storm howls above me and there's no hiding place. Mid the crash of the thunder, precious Lord, hear my cry. Keep me safe till the storm passes by. Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand. Keep me safe till the storm passes by. Many times Satan whispered, there is no need to try, for there's no end of sorrow, there's no hope by and by. But I know thou art with me, and tomorrow I'll rise where the storms never darken the skies. Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand. Keep me safe till the storm passes by. When the long night has ended and the storms come no more, let me stand in thy presence on that bright, peaceful shore, in that land where the tempest never comes. Lord, may I dwell with thee when the storm passes by. Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand. Keep me safe, hold me fast, let me stand till the storm passes by.
Well, I could sit here another hour and listen to all this music. It's been a blessing. James, let me tell you something. You have got a fabulous voice. I used to be able to sing like that. One of Sharon's favorite verses, you've heard it today three or four times, Psalm 118:23. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. As I contemplated and prayed over what I should say today, I thought about this verse. This verse demonstrates the depth of Sharon's faith. She was a real believer in the sovereignty of God. It reminded me of the song of Harriet Pearson. And by the way, Harriet Pearson was born 160 years before Sharon went home to be with the Lord to the day. And that song, What Though the Way Be Lonely, and dark shadows fall, I know where it leadeth. My Father planned it all. The sun may shine tomorrow, the shadows break and flee. 'Twill be the way He chooses. The Father's plan for me. He guides my haltering footsteps along the weary way, for well He knows the pathway will lead to endless day, a day of light and gladness on which no shade will fall. 'Tis this that last awaits me. My Father planned it all. This, March 10th, is the Lord's doing. Even her death, she would agree. This is the Lord's doing, and it's marvelous in our eyes. You know, I often think, what's she doing right now? She's hobnobbing around with the ladies of the Bible. I wonder if she's met Deborah yet, or Esther. I wonder if she's met Ruth and Naomi. When she took her final breath here, opened her eyes in heaven, I imagine she said, wow, this is the Lord's doing, and it's marvelous in our eyes. I was reading in my devotions this week, 2 Samuel chapter 3, and it tells the story of when King Saul died. Abner, the commander in his army, pledged his loyalty to David, the new king, not just in words, but in everything he did. Nevertheless, shortly after, Abner also was killed by a jealous rival. The word of Abner's death came to David. David said to his servants, know ye not that a prince and a great man is fallen in Israel? As I mulled over that phrase in my mind, I thought, when it comes to Sharon, I would say to you, know ye not that a princess and a great woman is fallen and is taken from us? We read in Matthew 18, Mark 9, and Luke 22 of a question on the minds of the disciples. They were arguing on this thought. Who's going to be the greatest in heaven? And the Lord's reply was, he that will be first shall be last, and he that is last shall be first. And he took a child and set the child in front of the disciples and said, whosoever will humble himself as a little child will be the greatest in heaven. Well, we all know the humility of Sharon Crowder. And she's going to be right up there with the first. I believe Sharon was a great woman because, first and foremost, she was a woman who knew the Lord as her Savior. There was a genuine relationship that anyone with any discernment could see and how she talked, and boy, did she talk. It was open to everyone that she knew Christ. She understood that she did not deserve that relationship, but by God's grace and boundless mercy, she humbled herself and accepted Christ years ago. Her faith in who Jesus is, God in the flesh. And what he did, he died on a cross and was buried. He rose again the third day for her personally. And you know, that makes the biggest difference. People believe that Jesus came, he died, he rose again. But until we make it personal, it's not counted for righteousness in our life. She had a wonderful relationship with Jesus. As she grew in the Lord, it was obvious that she was a humble woman who trusted God beyond most Christians. When I was visiting Brazil, I think it was 2008, I think that was when Brother Dirk and I went down there to teach at this seminary. We taught the first week, and then he flew back home to take care of the school, and I stayed another week, and we traveled, and on one occasion, we got to talking about all this new stuff people are trying in their churches and so forth, and she said this, "I don't understand these people. Why they think they have to improve God and his ways." You know, folks, we're not going to change God anyway, because he doesn't change. Can't improve on God. But that spirit of humility and quietness brought three wonderful characteristics to the forefront of our life. First, she walked comfortably before everyone. She walked with equal grace and dignity among all races and classes of people. We were walking down a street. I don't know what street it is, but it's where they have all of their shops and little situations where people bring all their goods out and people just walk, no traffic, just people walking, and they'll stop and they'll sell belts and ties and so forth. And I was walking with Sharon. She says, "Look at that guy." And I looked over, and here was a guy in checkered slacks, an older fella. He had a striped sport coat on. The slacks were blue checks. The sport coat was houndstooth brown. He had a bright pink shirt on and a Augusta National green tie on. And what was funny was he had stickers from all over the world stuck on his jacket, on his back. She says, "Look at that guy." And I thought, okay, she's going to criticize something. I'm going to really rag her on it. I said, "You know who he is, don't you?" She says, "Do you know him?" I said, "Yeah, he's a retired missionary." She laughed. I thought she was going to keel over. She started laughing so hard. Man-made distinctions made no difference to her. She was dignified, but not stuffy. Only eternity will reveal how many people she has encouraged to go on for the Lord. Such was a woman, Sharon Crowder. A humble woman who would always be willing to give the other person the benefit of the doubt. She was great in her humanness. She was a friend of the fallen. She was great in her patience with people. I know she had to be patient with me because I was sitting out in one of those chairs in the foyer, and I've told this before, but I sit out there after service and I just watch people. And I watch them talk. And Sharon had gestures. She was always moving her hands. And I would kid her and I'd say, you know, if someone tied your hands behind your back, you wouldn't be able to say a word. And she caught me watching her one day. And she went, sweet, sweet lady, patient with all people. She walked comfortably. She didn't have to prove anything to anybody. She didn't have to be in the limelight. Secondly, she walked consistently with the Lord. I believe she could do that because of her knowledge of the Word and simply trust that she just believed what God said. She was a woman of great character and Christian ethics. She was a woman of great faith. And by the way, that's what the Word of God does. It brings on faith. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. I remember that one morning, she was up and about, and she had a cup of coffee, and she had her Bible, and she was sitting there and having devotions, and it was early in the morning. I don't even think Roger was out of bed yet, but there she was reading her Bible. She knew the Word of God was inspired by God. God breathed. And because of it, you could say the Bible is a God thing and it's marvelous in our eyes. You think about that verse. Think about creation. And this world has a curse on it, and yet it is, you get away from the cities and so forth and see the nature and turn on the YouTube and follow a drone somewhere over the different countries. And this world is gorgeous. Think of salvation. And how Jesus came to this world. You just think about the gospel a minute. There's people today that do away with the Old Testament. We don't need the law. We're not under the law. Oh. But by the law is the knowledge of sin. And if we know we're sinners, then we know we need a Savior. And God knew we couldn't keep the law completely. And if we offend in one point, we're guilty of breaking all of it. And so God sent His Son to come to this world to take on a body so He could give that body in death and torture so we could trust Him as Savior and be saved. Salvation is the Lord's doing, and it's marvelous in our eyes. You think of Christ, when He left, He gave to the people, the believers, the Spirit of God to indwell us. And it's that Spirit that bonds people together. Causes us to grow, causes us to be conformed to the image of Christ. This too is wondrous in our eyes. Sharon was strong in the Lord because she met God every morning. She depicted that poem by Ralph Chrisman, who said, "I met God in the morning when the day was at its best, and his presence came like sunrise, like glory in my breast. All day long his presence lingered, all day long he stayed with me, and we sailed with perfect calmness over every troubled sea. Other ships were blown and battered, other ships were sore distressed, but the winds that seemed to drive them brought to us both peace and rest. So I think I know the secret learned from many a troubled way. You must seek him in the morning if you want him the rest of the day." And I believe Sharon became a great woman of faith, and her faith caused her to walk comfortably before all men. And her faith caused her to be consistent with the Lord. Thirdly, she walked confidently for eternity. She knew what she believed. No one was going to talk her out of it. Even as the Apostle Paul told Timothy in 2 Timothy 1:12, "For I know whom I've believed and am persuaded that he's able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day." This is what Sharon's faith assured her of. And I think everyone here who really knew her would agree and reflect Paul's words, "I fought a good fight. I finished my course. And I've kept the faith." How do I believe that? Why do I believe that? Because Sharon was saturated with the scriptures. And that caused her to be sound in her faith. And that caused her to be steadfast to the end. Now you couple all of that with her graciousness, her patience, her humility, and we'll have to agree that March 10th, about 4 p.m., that a great woman was taken from us. Oh, I'm glad for that verse in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. We sorrow, but we don't sorrow without as a person without hope. We're to comfort one another with those thoughts. I've often, in almost every funeral, I've often thought, what would the person say if they could speak to the congregation? And if she could say anything today, she would probably say, "All of this is the Lord's doing, bringing the family together, having all the different types of singing and the music, praising God, fellowshipping together. It is marvelous in my sight, because absent from the body is present with the Lord." I want to close with this, again showing the sovereignty of God. "My Father's way may twist and turn, my heart may throb and ache, but in my soul I'm glad I know he maketh no mistake. My cherished plans may go astray, my hopes may fade away, but still I'll trust my Lord to lead, for he doth know the way. Though night be dark and it may seem that day will never break, I'll pin my faith, my all in him. He maketh no mistake." There's so much now that you cannot see, your eyesight far too dim. But come what may, surely trust and leave it all to him. For by and by the mist will lift and plain it all he'll make. though all the way, though dark to me, he made not one mistake. See, she didn't just claim that verse as a life verse. She lived the life verse. It really was her. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. Let's pray together. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for Sharon Crowder. And Lord, if she's close to the throne right now, I would ask you to say hello for us. Thank you, Lord, for her obvious Christian growth in her life, for her loyalty and love for the Word of God, for her great faith that the Word of God produced, for her love for the churches that they ministered in, and especially Calvary Baptist Church here. Lord, for her love and encouragement she gave to those in the church, we will miss her. Father, we pray for comfort in knowing she had a great love for preachers who were faithful in preaching the truth without compromise. We thank you for her genuine humility, for a woman who stood head and shoulders above the crowd and never knew it. For her down-to-earth compassion, her joyful disposition and consistency of life. For a person who understood and accepted and lived out the will of God to the end. Father, we pray for Brother Roger and Kelly and Shelley and all the family. Give much grace and help to each of them through difficult times. And when the waves of emotion come upon them, may they remember Jesus is coming again. And so, Lord, we agree with the psalmist that this is your doing, and that everything has been marvelous in our eyes. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. At this particular time, her grandchild is going to sing. It's going to be on video because she's not here. Do we have that ready? We've got it ready, okay? Turn your eyes on Jesus. You listen. Now, it's going to be in Portuguese, but the words, I think, are going to be up there, okay? Thank you.